Welcome to All About Frome. I'm Rupert Kirkham, and today we're live in the studio, and with COP26 looming, we're going to talk about how we can do our part to address the climate change issues which are already on our doorstep. To that end, we have four local people with various expertise and experience, both in the studio and on Zoom. In the studio, Grace Maddrell, youth activist and author; Verity White, director of the Wild Carbon Fund and a former producer at the BBC Natural History Unit; Nikki Brain, resilience officer for Frome Town Council, on a memory stick because he had something else planned at this time, just down the corridor. We hear from Peter Macfadyen, founder of Sustainable Frome and advisor to the Gaia Foundation. We've also got an extract from a new project to come out of Sustainable Frome, a new radio show on Frome FM. And with us on Zoom is the presenter, or the co-presenter of that show, Mike Grenville. Now, our first guest is Nikki Brain, who's the resilience officer for the council. I asked Nikki how much influence and support locally the Frome Town Council thought it could make in terms of people's reactions to the issues that are being discussed at COP29 and the general social issues surrounding the eco movement in Frome.
Is staff, and staff time is really important. We don't necessarily need a lot of money if we've got staff to go out and talk to people in the community and come up with creative projects. Mm. Probably an example that I would give is the Solar Streets project. So that's something that we set up back in 2018, and it's a bulk buy deal with a local installer. So if we can get 10 or more people in Frome to agree to install solar panels, then they get a significant discount. And that's something that obviously took staff time and contact to set up. Yeah. And it takes staff time in terms of organising meetings. So we organised a meeting back in May and about 90 people in Frome turned up.
Now, would you say that was a good response?
I would say so, yeah. I think we've had about the same number of installations over the past few years and hoping that will just keep increasing.
Mm. You say 90 people. So if that's a good number, we've got, 28,000 people in this catchment area, yeah, at least. What sort of influence do you think the town council has over people's actions, really? I mean, we've got a lot going on, but obviously only a few hundred people, if you're lucky, turn up to any of them. How much of an impact can we really expect to make? Can you really expect to make as a town council?
Well, I think it's not necessarily about telling people what to do. I've just been in a meeting next door, which is about the potential to create a recycling and reuse centre in Frome. So there were 30 people in that meeting who've kind of come along from the community, and all of them are individually involved in projects already around waste and recycling. So actually, if you look at sort of the network effect, there's so many people, and that's what I love about being in Frome, is that there are people who are willing to put their hands up, get involved, they're creative, they come up with new solutions, so it's not something that we're doing by ourselves.
And you've got, it isn't, and an example of that was the Big Green Week, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
So what were the sort of initiatives there that worked well?
So I think some of the most popular events were the walks. So we had a lot of kind of organised nature walks throughout the week, which sold out pretty fast, just kind of getting people out into our green spaces and connecting with each other. We also had an Improve Don't Move event on the Saturday, it was an exhibition hosting people, companies who can help with home energy insulation, with renewables, with interior design, using recycled materials. We also had a big food event down at the station on the Saturday, which was called We Feed Frome, which had, there were a lot of stall holders who produce food locally in Frome, and it was a chance for people to come and like try their produce, find out how they produce their food sustainably, and kind of get the message out there around buying local and buying sustainable.
Do you think people are doing that more now? I mean, have you got any evidence of that?
I think so. Well, I think just anecdotally, really, just the fact that climate is everywhere. I've been working in the field for about 8 years, and when I started, it felt like it was a sort of a fringe issue that popped up every now and again in the media. And now I think just people's awareness and concern is just off the charts compared to what it was a few years ago.
I mean, it did sort of start with the farmers markets, didn't it, about 25 years ago, really. I mean, that was when people started to think about local produce and products and producers and, you know, air miles and things like that. Mm. So it's been in the back of everyone's minds. Verity, do you have any experience of, you know, the knowledge in your, you live in Churchill, which is, you know, in, well, it's in Somerset, isn't it?
Yeah, North Somerset. I'd say the local food movement there has still got a way to go. Perhaps Frome's ahead of the game. I've been using a local box delivery, somersetlocal.com, for about 10 years now. And I know that they had a big peak actually with the COVID when people stopped. Suddenly we couldn't do our orders because a lot of other people had jumped in and filled up the orders. And I'm sure some of those customers have stayed when they've realised the benefits, realised how nice it is to have that local product produce and be connected to what you're eating a bit better. So I don't have huge experience apart from my own personal experience, but you know, I think it's certainly something that's, in fact, even in our local budgeons now, they've got local food stickers on local products, and they occasionally do local food displays. Which
but of course, the money goes out of town, doesn't it, usually to budgeons rather than. I mean, obviously, it goes to local producers as well.
Well, yeah, right? I think they'd be pretty pleased to be in budgeons. I think if I was a local food producer, budgeons would be.
But of course, there's all this. There's an economy of scale here, and obviously, local. Local farmers can't meet the demands of local supermarkets, so that's a bit of a problem.
No, supermarkets are definitely a problem. I've worked with a lot of farmers in my filmmaking career about the pressures of supermarket delivery and the pressures of driving down prices, and that's I think it makes a big difference if you can avoid that and deal directly with your food producer.
Yeah. Grace, what's you're a vegetarian?
Vegan, actually.
A vegan, of course. So, obviously, underlying reasons are about land use and things like that, are they? I mean, what's your main motivation?
So I started being vegan because, well, I've always been vegetarian, but I started being vegan because I guess I was sort of aligning my personal life more with the activism I did. There are obviously a lot of nuances there and individual changes, not where it's at on the whole, because we need a systemic change. So I would never pressure anyone else into making that choice. But that was why I made that choice at that point.
Okay, well, back to Nikki just briefly. You've got a collaboration going on called Green and Healthy Futures with Adventure, which is a local educational organisation, and through medical practice. Just could you outline that for us and where that fits into what we're talking about, really?
Yeah, of course. So it's a 2-year lottery funded partnership, which is the one I referred to through the Climate Action Fund. So Adventure have produced a lot of really successful kind of startup projects with young people in Frome. And then obviously the medical practice is huge. It has about 30,000 patients and they're incredibly well trusted in the community. So we've come together with this programme over 2 years to explore the links between climate and health, because actually a lot of the things that are good for the planet are also good for us. And it's sort of, you know, looking at it through that lens might bring in people who might not ordinarily involve themselves in climate conversations. So just to give two examples of projects that we're running through that programme, I'm working with the Centre for Sustainable Energy to provide home energy advice and help people understand how to access grant funding for things like home insulation. There's actually quite a lot of funding out there at the moment for kind of lower income households, but it's just not well advertised. And also kind of trying to help people do things like switching bills and kind of simple, kind of smaller home improvements that they can do themselves that will reduce energy bills. And obviously the link there between climate and health is, you know, reduce bills, reduce carbon emissions, financial savings, but also if you live in a cold and drafty home and have underlying health conditions, then that will exacerbate them. So so there's a link there. And obviously working with the GP, working with the medical practice, means that that message is coming from a really trusted provider. So we might get that message out further than we would if it was just CSE or the council talking about it by ourselves. Another scheme that we're running is called Cycle Together. So we have a month-long e-bike trial along with cycle confidence lessons to get people who might not have cycled before, might not feel confident on the road to kind of get into cycling. So we support them through that process for a month. And so far, the feedback that we've got from the people who've taken part is that they're going to continue to kind of take more of their short journeys actively rather than jumping in the car.
Interestingly enough, there's a new show on Frome FM, which has just started last Monday, and it's based on an organisation. Well, it's from made by an organisation called Sustainable Frome, and in a minute we'll be talking to one of its directors. But we've got the person who started Sustainable Frome, Peter Macfadyen. As a recording, he was going to be with us, but he actually had something else he had to do at the same time, just down the corridor here, in fact. So I'd like just to play what he has to say about what we're talking about, really.
Rupert, many thanks for inviting me to make a few comments on the conference of the parties coming up in Glasgow. So I'm really sorry I can't join you. I'm round the corner, actually, trying to help design a reuse centre for Frome, which is not unconnected, but not quite as big as what's going on up there. I think the main thing I want to say is that by the end of this year, the world will have burned through 86% of the carbon budget that would allow us to have any chance of keeping the temperature below 1.5 degrees centigrade. So we're in deep, deep trouble, is my main feeling. The world is actually set for a 2.7 degrees centigrade increase by the end of this century, even if all the emissions reductions pledges are met. So the Glasgow COP somehow has to try and bring things back incredibly in a huge way. You know, their ambition has to be enormous. So, you know, I wish the people doing the negotiating luck, but we really are in deep trouble. And I think what that means is that we need to recognise as humanity that it's very unlikely that those targets will be met. And that will have catastrophic consequences for most of the living things on the planet, including obviously us. So, you know, I'd encourage everyone to write, phone, email, campaign, go to Glasgow if you possibly can. Decision makers need to feel the heat and to feel that, feel the heat that they're failing to stem. And also, I think the younger generation really needs to see that while it may be very, very late, any sane person is actually trying to do what they can. It's incredibly important for their and our mental health to be doing everything that we can. I'd also encourage people to act locally, get behind the green and healthy project of the health centre, the town council and adventure, and, you know, indeed any other local environmental project that you can find. There's more and more of them, even at a sort of hyper local level, encouraging people to work in their gardens. The neighbourhood network, which is all over Frome, is working to make this easier. So I'd really encourage people to do things locally, because it's actually really important to be doing the right thing, even if that may feel quite small. And if you want to chat about that or anything else, I and a few others will be sat at a table, probably opposite WH Smith's, during the COP period, so starting from Saturday the 30th of October, ending on November the 13th, as many days as we can. We'll be there or around there or outside the library, depending on where we get thrown off from, probably, with the table and chairs. And we'll be happy to listen, happy to answer questions where we can, mainly to listen, I think, and hear what people think. It's a challenging time for all sorts of reasons. And the climate's been sidelined a bit by COVID, but it's rearing its ugly head in ways that we really need to get on top of. So thanks again for asking me to comment, and good luck with the rest of the conversation.
Thanks, Peter, for that, which he recorded yesterday. And so just to remind you, that's Peter Macfadyen, founder of Sustainable Frome, which has just started a new show, as I said earlier. Here's an extract from that show with presenters Mike Grenville and Alex Hart.
Jenny Shackelford, who lives in Frome, is, as we speak, walking all the way, actually from Bristol to Glasgow to be at COP26, along with, I think there's about 40 other people from various places, on an interfaith walk to highlight their response and to really connect with communities along the route and to really reflect on the issues of climate change and what needs to be done to respond to the situation that the world is in. And one of our other key members of Sustainable Frome, Maddie Moore, has set off. I think she's starting on Saturday. She's catching them up, and they're going to arrive in Glasgow at the end of October. So
there's going to be a big presence of people from Frome at COP, as far as I'm aware. We'll have the blackbirds there, Frome's very own blackbirds, made by the fantastic woman who runs Poppycock. She made those costumes, and they're now internationally recognised, aren't they?
Are they? Yes. Say more about the blackbirds. What's that mean for people who don't know about them?
Do you know about that, Nikki?
I don't know.
So the idea was that it's an alarm call. Blackbirds are very good at, if you listen out, they'll let you know. Anyone who's got chickens will know this. The blackbirds will make a noise that will make all the chickens go, oh, whoa, something's going on. And so this is what the blackbirds represent. This is an alarm call. Wake up, everybody. Something really bad is going on and you need to be aware of it. And they're visually very striking, very funny. They're all male. They forgot to put the female blackbirds in there, but that's just a small point. I think you can see a lovely interview with Maddie, who is interviewing Jenny.
Yeah.
If you go to the Sustainable Frome website, you might find that. It's a lovely piece of it explains more what the walk is about.
Yeah.
An extract from Sustainable Frome, the new eco show on Frome FM every fourth Monday from October the 11th. That means that the next one's available from November the 8th, and then it's online at frome.fm after that. Mike is with us now on Zoom, Mike Grenville. Mike, Sustainable Frome, the eco show, is very new, but obviously Sustainable Frome has been going for 13 years. What's your what's the idea behind the show?
It's really to highlight a lot of the things that are going on in Frome, because actually there's a lot of stuff that goes on in Frome, and we really want to highlight that for people to know what's going on, and to share some of the great projects that people are doing. Really on all sorts of areas, because everything that we do makes a difference. And I think that certainly the mainstream media doesn't always report the things that are going on, and they report the kind of disasters. And there's a lot of really good things that go on that really everybody doing something makes a difference. So that's kind of behind it, is really showing, particularly in Frome, what we can do and what is actually happening, and things that you can get involved in, or ideas, that's the main reason for the show.
So as far as COP26 is concerned, have you got any presence at COP26? Are you going to be there?
Not officially, but there are certainly a number of people from Frome who are going to be, as you heard in the clip just now, there are certainly two people from Frome who are walking there, and there are certainly others who are going in different ways. But I think, you know, I think one has to be careful about over expectation about what might come out of COP. And yes, it's an important event and it creates a focus, but whatever actually happens at COP, we can still do our bit, and that makes a difference too. So one shouldn't feel completely downhearted if the pundits afterwards say, "Well, that was a bit of a waste of time." And
but they will, won't they? I mean, a lot of people will say that.
They will, and certainly Greta Thunberg, is just, you know, her her summary of what's going to happen there before it even happens is blah, 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 blah. And I'm afraid there's a certain truth in that. But, you know, we can come back to everybody making a difference, because what you do does make a difference in all sorts of ways. It makes a difference to you, to your neighbours, and to it puts a pressure onto the councils, to the government and so on. Everything you do, it affects, you don't always know how much an effect it has. So I really encourage people to just do something, do what you can.
Okay, Mike, thank you for that for the moment. We'll come back to you, and I think we'll talk a little bit more about some of the issues at COP26, because there's some major problems that I don't think they can solve. Anyway, we'll come back to that. Thanks, Mike, for the moment. One of the people in Frome who has been doing a lot practically to try and do something locally and also internationally is Grace Maddrell. Grace, we dragged you off the street and into the studio over 2 years ago when you were protesting outside the town hall for months on end in all weathers, raising awareness of the plight of the Congo rainforest. How many days did you actually do?
Well, in total of strikes, including digital strikes, which is just like a photo of you with a sign, I did, I think, about 500 days, but not exactly because I miscounted, so it may have been about 502 or 503.
Okay.
But something along the lines of 500 days, including digitally, yeah.
As I said, you were out there in all weathers. What kind of a response did you get on the street?
A lot of the time, no response. A lot of people just kind of ignored me. On the whole, I got more positive responses when I did get a response than negative responses. I got some people coming up and asking questions, and I would direct them to a petition and, you know, Twitter to find out more about it. And obviously I got, you know, people occasionally wanting an interview. So, you know, partly how I ended up here. And yeah, I got the odd person being like, why are you doing this? You should be in school. But mostly it was fairly positive response.
Mm.
But yeah. Most people didn't respond at all.
No. And so you've been through a lot personally, and you've come a long way politically since then. You're now the author of a book that's just had some great reviews, one of them from The New Scientist, no less. And you wrote an article fairly recently, I think September, wasn't it, for the Independent newspaper. Tell us about your book, an overview of what it is. And a bit about your journey since those days outside the town hall.
So I started working on my book, which is called Tomorrow is Too Late and is published by Indigo Press, in November 2019. I wanted to create a compilation of like pieces of writing, I guess you could call them essays, by youth climate activists from all over the world. So I basically just reached out on Twitter and I was like, hey, does anyone want to do this? And a lot of people responded, and I also contacted some people, and some of them responded and some of them didn't. And not everyone who responded ended up in the book because deadlines are a thing. So, but yeah, I just decided that I wanted to try and do this project, and the response was really amazing. And although I'm credited as, you know, the author slash editor of the book because I compiled it, I think so much credit has to go to the 40 or so people who contributed to it, because without them there would literally be no book. So I can't say all their names because there were 40 of them, but yeah, all those people who contributed to it definitely made it into what it is now.
You did have a big network. Well, I'm assuming you still do have a big internet network of, you know, on Twitter and what other platforms did you use? Because I followed you on Twitter I still do. But I mean, there are an awful lot of people all over the world who are, you know, looking at what Greta Thunberg has done and aligning themselves with all that, with that movement. And you're very much part of that. So, I mean, did any of these people that you're in touch with on a daily basis write for the book?
So most of the people that wrote for the book I did find on Twitter. There was the odd person who I found through like some other platform or through a friend of theirs. You know, sometimes I had to go like three steps, like, here's this activist from this place and they know someone from this place who knows someone who could write for the book. So it could be a bit of a like convoluted thing. But yeah, most of them were on Twitter, and some of those are people that I would have been working with and contacting regularly. Notably, Vanessa Nakate, who started the Safe Congo Rainforest campaign that I was part of. We knew each other because I became part of that campaign, so I asked her to write for the book, and a couple of other people from that campaign I also asked to write for the book. But many of them I just came across on Twitter, and I might know them already, and I might not, but I just, you know, contacted them, or they got in touch with me, and it was like, oh, do you want to be part of this? Or, hey, I want to be part of this. And I was like, sure. And one or two of the people I've known in real life, but on the whole, it was mostly just online.
Yeah. I was going to say, did you actually get to meet any of these people yet?
So I've met some of them incidentally, not in connection with the book, because two of them were part of a friendship group I was in at some point, so I've met them a couple of times, and one or two others have been at strikes and protests that I've gone to, and I've met quite a few of them over Zoom, but yeah, I haven't met most of them because they're international.
Well, so. They're all in other countries, but yeah. So how positive do you feel about the future now you've been through all this, and now you've got a handle on how many committed people, young people, there are out there? Do you feel positive?
I can't say I feel positive about actually meeting targets and doing stuff, because as much as people go on about how our generation is going to save the world, blah, 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 the point is that whilst we can make an impact, the people making the decisions right now are overwhelmingly from other generations who, with many, many, many exceptions, but do seem to be a little bit less invested in, you know, stopping catastrophe, because, you know, they like their money and their economy and their power, and they're mostly in very privileged positions, so they're going to be less affected by the crisis. So I don't think I necessarily feel hopeful that there's going to be a massive attitude change among these people. And sadly, that is going to, you know, make a crucial difference as to whether, you know, whether they get replaced or whether their attitudes change as to whether we actually meet these targets and avert any of the catastrophes, although it's worth noting that so much is happening already in so many places and countries, and some of it's been happening for years and years. So when people talk about, like, stopping this, it's like, we want to avert worse impacts, but we have to acknowledge that there are a lot already happening.
I mean, there's an awful lot of money wasted, isn't there, on wars and things like that, you know, all over the world. There are billions of dollars and other currency going into offensive actions. And in order to get any of that money, you have to change people's attitudes completely about confrontation and so on. Is there any hope? We don't have time to do that, do we?
I mean, I don't know all the ins and outs of all of it. Like, I haven't looked at what every country's budget is going on and, you know, how it works in all the political situations. But obviously, yeah, an attitude change is the most fundamental thing, which is why when I talk about individual change being mostly not where it's at, the one individual change that, you know, is really important is an attitude change. Because if everyone has an attitude change, then it's going to help pressure the people in power to do something. And if they have an attitude change, then, you know, we might actually have a chance at least averting some of the worst impact. But, I mean, I don't know. I think we have not very much time, and most of the people in power are still pretty selfish, you know, and a lot of them are, like, fascists. So I don't know how much of a chance we have, but I do feel hopeful that there is hope for, you know, people to not just keep destroying each other, you know, to an extent, at least when I look at a lot of the people in my generation, including those who've written for the book. So, yeah, do I have hope that we're going to meet all these targets? Well, yeah, obviously I have a bit of hope, but I feel like it's kind of unlikely. But do I have hope that, you know, my generation might actually be, you know, a bit better at trying to have each other's backs when a lot of crises hit? Yeah, I would say I was more hopeful for that.
Well, thank goodness for that. So I'm going to ask you in a little while if you might be good enough to read a couple of extracts from your book, if that's all right. You could have a look at for one or two.
Yeah.
but let's just go to Verity now. Now, Verity White, you're a highly experienced natural history filmmaker. But you're also about rewilding, and to that end, you're the director of an organisation called Wild Carbon Fund. Can you tell us about that project?
Yeah, sure. Well, I've spent my career travelling and going to some of the wilder places on the earth. I've filmed in the Congo, which was very difficult to find anywhere with enough animals to film, sadly.
Because they've all been eaten.
Eaten, suffering from deforestation. As habitat loss is the big problem.
Right.
And but I've also filmed lots and lots of incredible projects and people doing really good work and in a very heartening way. And that was sort of, I felt like I didn't want to just be filming the people doing the good work anymore, and that I wanted to, join in, become a little bit more effective, because the hope thing. Sometimes I feel hopeful, sometimes not so much. But it's the fact that I can't rely on anybody else to be doing anything because our politicians are clearly failed so far.
I just wanted to go back to that business about filming people in situations that you're powerless to deal with. That's obviously, that's a big problem for journalists all over the world, really. You're supposed to be there to report on what's going on and not actually get involved. But that is very difficult, isn't it?
It is. I mean, some of these projects, you're sort of happy to kind of pack it all up and just stay and help. But that's sort of not what happens when you move on to the next one. There's a series out on the BBC at the moment called Restoring the Earth, the Age of Nature, which I worked on, and that showcases some really wonderful examples of people doing really good work. And that's a very hopeful series because the narrative around climate change and the end of the world is very depressing. It causes anxiety, it's disengaging. So we wanted to show some stories where people are getting things right and they are achieving quite, big scale stuff. To show people the way forward.
When is that? When's that on? Is it on yet?
Yeah, it's on BBC4. There's two episodes on iPlayer. It's on, and the next one, the third one, which is about climate change, is on tomorrow at 10 o'clock.
Brilliant. And you were involved in that?
Yes.
Excellent. All right, so I interrupted you. But the rewilding idea, has been going on for some time. We've recently asked the royal family if they wouldn't mind rewilding the hundreds of thousands of acres of land that they own. How practical, how realistic is it, and where does your project look for participants in this?
Well, if I can tell you sort of how it formed. So it's now common practice in my natural history filmmaking industry to offset the carbon from our travel. We often have quite hefty carbon footprints. We send crews and kit around the world, and now we offset. And when we came to offset the Age of Nature, I was struggled to find anything that I was satisfied with that was a good way to spend the money. I'm sort of, there's a lot of greenwashing going on out there with carbon offsetting. There's a lot of tree planting, inappropriate tree planting. What I wanted to do was use that money to buy space for nature, because that's what nature needs. And so I started the Wild Carbon Fund, particularly wanting to do something UK-based, because our nature here is very depleted. I think we're 12th bottom country in the world for nature, which is a great embarrassment.
Yeah, what does that mean exactly? 12.
That means our biodiversity is very low, our forest cover is very low, our natural spaces, our national parks are small in comparison with other countries.
Right, okay.
It's cheaper to offset your carbon abroad where land is cheaper, where labour is cheaper, but it doesn't mean we shouldn't perhaps be doing something in our own backyard as well.
Can you just go in a little bit into this process of offsetting? I mean, it's not just a question of paying a bit of money extra on your air tickets.
Well, it is a box-ticking exercise, which we want to, again, move away from, because by doing something local, people can really understand where their money's going, what's going to be happening to a piece of land if it's given back to nature, how the species might return, how the flora and fauna will change, if it's a piece of arable land which might have been emitting carbon, it's intensively farmed, how that will change quickly to absorbing carbon. And if you're doing a box-ticking exercise on EasyJet, you don't think any further than that.
No,
whereas
no.
We'll offer a service that means people can get a bit more involved.
And that's going to be a sort of corporate service in the sense?
We're talking to corporate people because obviously they have big carbon offsetting budgets. We're aiming for net zero. That's an impossibility without carbon offsetting because the rate with which we're reducing our dependency on fossil fuels is very slow. Mm. You can buy carbon neutral petrol if you want to, if you believe that's really a thing, but you can buy it.
It's a bit bizarre, that, isn't it?
And a lot of that carbon offsetting money, like I said, is potentially misspent on projects that are planting eucalyptus trees. Timber, sort of growing timber for our use is fine, but
Mike wants to come in for a second. But he doesn't want to come in for a second. Okay. Do you think, we'll go back to the rewilding project. What do you think that people have somehow, through the last 2 years of lockdown and so on, become a little bit more in touch with their nature around them? And
I think we certainly
the way it rebounds when you leave it alone. And that
yeah,
kind of thing.
We learned a couple of things in lockdown. One is that nature's very good for us. And that we need it. It's very good for our mental health. It's good for our physical health. To have access to space in nature is quite limited. If you live somewhere around here, you're lucky. If you live in a city, not so much. You know, often these footpaths are sort of stuck to field boundaries, and you don't have the chance to stand in a big green space and feel the wind and breathe the air. So that's something that we've learned. And the other thing is that when we sort of stepped back out of nature, when we were properly locked up, there was anecdotal evidence. I mean, nature doesn't move that fast all the time, but I think people talked about nature coming back and animals coming back, and I think partly that was because people were stopping to notice.
It was always there, they just didn't see it,
weren't looking at it. I think there was a great joy in that discovery.
But I mean, there is, if you don't mow your lawn, you know, you suddenly get a vast number of insects.
Yeah, if you leave your grass to grow, you'll get eight times the biodiversity. Yeah.
I mean, those things are so easy to do. Mm-hmm. And then you just have to bury the idea of neat green stripes.
No, well, that's the attitude change that Grace was talking about. Yeah, You know, we don't need to be tidy. Nature isn't very tidy. We're very, very controlling as a species.
We are controlling.
We really
like to get
stuck in. And what we'd like to do is do the minimal effort for the restoration and let nature do it in its own time. It might be slow, it might be brambly to start with, might be impenetrable, hard to manage, hard for us to stomach, but in time, which is what nature needs, it'll settle itself and you know, it'll keep changing. It's not going to grow to a woodland and then stay like that forever.
So your project now is in its sort of in infancy, really, in terms of having active projects running around the country. So where is it now? What are you doing now?
Yeah, we are in the early stages, and our first step is to we've raised some funding, and we're running a PhD project with the University of the West of England because we want to start measuring the greenhouse gas emissions of soils in certain rewilding situations compared to tree planting, compared to farmland, because there is a lack of data. And if you want to quantify something and sell it, if we want that carbon offsetting money to go into complex nature, we need to have a few figures be able to sort of squeeze it into some bigger boxes, perhaps, than it gets put in already.
Is it part? Do you think that COP26 can address this, the whole area of rewilding, in any meaningful way?
Well, I'd like to see a change from the tree planting hysteria that goes on to just space for nature and to let nature recover. If it's a grassland, if it's a wetland, if it's a forest, we just let that happen and perhaps, you know, emphasise as much importance on biodiversity as we do on carbon, because for me it's the same thing. It's just nature. We just need nature to be healthy, and then our planet will be in better condition.
Okay, so do you think, I was going to say about COP26, one of the places most people get their information about nature is through documentaries like the ones you make. And do you not think that your skills would be are more effectively used by making films for hundreds of thousands of people to view than trying to persuade a few companies to get,
do a little bit of both. I think
you've got to earn some money too, haven't you?
Well, I do need to earn some money. That's the thing. We'll have a look at The Age of Nature for an example of a film that, you know, I've made a lot of wildlife films for the BBC over the years, but this is probably the one that I'm most proud of. It's not perfect, but I think it might
what
be
was,
the most
What were you doing? Were you useful. The director?
As a series producer.
Series producer, right, brilliant.
And
did you get plenty of resources to make that?
It wasn't bad. It was a PBS and BBC Worldwide co-production.
Right.
BBC Community Channel bought it later when it was done. They didn't perhaps want to invest in the beginning, but anyway, they've got it now and it's out on BBC Four at 10 o'clock. But thank goodness there's an iPlayer link for that people can share, and you know, it's had some lovely reviews. It's even had positive reviews in the more sort of right wing papers because it is a positive series and people respond really well to that. I mean, it's realistic.
It's above politics, all this, isn't it? I mean, right.
Well, we've got a politician in there. It isn't. It's easier to get a environmental discussion going on the Guardian than it is to get one in the Telegraph. So, you know, to have one in the Telegraph, we call that a thumbs up.
Right. Okay. Now, just a final question: would you like to see a film production fund coming out of COP26? Do you think that's at all realistic?
Well, I think a great criticism of my industry, and something that's probably deserved, is that we haven't done our bit over the last 20 years to address environmental issues in our films. We like to show people escapism. We like to show people the beauty of nature. But, you know, I'm guilty of this as well. Quite often you'll film something and make it look spectacular, and if you pan slightly to the left, there'd be a car park. And, you know, if you're really unlucky, you know, a mine or a deforestation project. And I think that has been a little disingenuous, and again, that is slowly changing now. Well, it's finally, it's kind of, we've got there. The Age of Nature wouldn't have gone out 10 years ago, even though it should have. Earth shots on BBC One, celebrities are involved, everybody's cheering. But there's a lot more detail to go into than that.
And what do you think about Earth shot?
I think it's a way to get people engaged. We need to engage the public on a broad level. Otherwise, you're only talking to your echo chamber, aren't you? And whereas people might not respond to little environmental series on BBC Four, they might respond to Coldplay on BBC One. So I think everything has its place.
Okay. But for the moment, thanks, Verity. I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to use a track that you yourself have used on your showreel on the website for your filmmaking business, Five Films. And if anyone wants to check out Verity's website, it's fivefilms.org. It's Only Human from Rag and Bone Man.
Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived in what you believe? 'Cause I'm only human after all, and you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Some people got the real problems. Some people out of love. Some people think I can solve them. Lord, heaven's above. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. Don't ask my opinion, don't ask me to lie, and beg for forgiveness for making you cry. For making you cry. 'Cause I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. Oh, some people got the real problems. Some people out of love. Some people think I can solve them. Lord, heaven's above. I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me.
only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. I'm only human, I do what I can. I'm just a man, I do what I can. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me.
I'm only human from Rag and Bone Man. Now, I said earlier that we've got Grace Maddrell in the studio. She's just written a book, and we're going to ask her just to read a couple of extracts from that book, because it's very timely, and I think it will lead to further discussion. Grace.
Okay, so in the same vein of campaigns that I've done before and people who start that campaigns, I figured it made sense to read the essay by Vanessa Nakate, who started the Save Congo Rainforest campaign, which I was part of for a long time. So I'm just going to like skip a bit of the introductory bit, because it's just like, hello, this is my name, you know, blah, blah. So this is her essay. So firstly, she says a bit on the Congo rainforest. The Congo rainforest is the largest in Africa, and it's home to various species of animals and plants. Millions of people heavily depend on the forest and on all of us to protect the forest from any destruction. Becoming a climate activist was a process for me. In the year 2018, I wanted to do something that could cause a change in the lives of the people in my community. I researched to understand the problems faced by the people in my community. That climate change is one of those problems was a surprise to me. I had been in school, and all along the teachers had made me and other students think that climate change had already happened in the past, or that it was coming in the far future, and that we didn't have to worry about it. I decided to read more about climate change to understand the causes and the impacts. I then realized that some of these consequences were already being experienced in some rural communities. For example, the Mount Elgon area in Uganda has experienced torrential rainfall leading to flooding and landslides. I have seen the victims cry out to the government for help after losing everything about their life and survival. That is, loss of their houses, loss of lives, and loss of their farms, which are the only source of survival. I see the pain as they cry out for help because of the devastating and frustrating disasters that leave them with absolutely nothing. Most of the people heavily depend on subsistence farming as a source of survival, and this clearly explains that climate change greatly affects the availability of food, leading to food scarcity. There is also a problem of water scarcity in areas that are hit with intense droughts. I have seen the number of street children increase in Kampala, and I have personally observed that these children come from the same region which has always been known to experience semi-arid conditions. With the increase in global temperatures, these places become uninhabitable for these children and their parents. This shows how much climate change is changing lives and forcing people to leave their homes and travel to the city for paradise, only to find out they have to beg on the streets to survive. As a climate activist, I want world leaders to step up their game. They need to stop risking our lives only because of profits that benefit small populations. People are suffering while others are dying. Now is the time for world leaders to take responsibility and protect our planet. Our home is in jeopardy. Our future is uncertain. We are not sure of our survival. World leaders need to stop thinking that we still have time. We don't have any time left. The people on the front lines of the climate crisis can't live anymore because of their decisions. We lost time the moment these people started dying and suffering. We need to change now. We need action. We are tired of empty words and promises. We want to see real change happening. We want a better world. We want a better future, and it is possible to get it. All we need is for leaders to take charge and clean up the mess they caused. We need to save the future now. The present is already messed up. World leaders need to completely give up the fossil fuel industry. It is possible to transition to more sustainable paths to development. We want to see more sustainable cities, breathing clean air, and study knowing that the future is certain. Now is the time for world leaders to shift from temporary pleasures to things that will save our lives and secure a cleaner and healthier environment. The climate crisis terrifies me. It's like, or even worse than, a horror story. I have dreams and hopes. I have things that I want to achieve in my life, but how can I live normally and work on achieving my dreams with a future that is so uncertain? I am not okay. I'm worried. I'm scared. I don't want to be a victim of climate change. Every time I find out that more people have died because of climate change, it breaks my heart. We need to put an end to this now. I want my normal life back. I want to feel that my future is secure. Everything is just frustrating. The thought of waking up and everything being completely gone is also very disturbing. This crisis is not good for anyone's mental or physical health. Every activist in the climate movement is very inspirational. Knowing that you're with so many people demanding the same thing is so motivating and encouraging. Sometimes it feels like no one is listening. It feels like I am all alone, but when I remember the other young people striking for a better future, it gives me peace and hope. That is how I keep moving forward. My advice to fellow activists would be that they should not give up, no matter what happens. Everyone is important and respected in this movement. Every voice matters in this movement. Keep demanding for action. Keep striking. We are together in this, and we shall win. When you feel alone, try to reach out to any other activist. There are millions of people cheering you on. There are millions of people supporting you. We love you and we are with you. Don't ever feel alone. To anyone who would like to join climate activism, everyone is welcome. Find a local group near you that you can work with. You don't need to start from scratch. We are a global movement. We work together. We support you. We are with you. That was from Vanessa Nakate, who is an activist from Uganda.
Fantastic. Yeah. Do you think that your book's going to help spread, you know, that's a very powerful piece of writing. And obviously, I don't know if she's published it before, but that's your book going to be quite a resource, I would have thought, for young climate activists. Do you reckon on doing another one soon? I mean, that could run and run, couldn't it?
I hope it will be a good resource. I'm not sure I will personally be doing another one, but if someone reads Tomorrow is Too Late and they are still interested, there are a lot of other books on this topic you can read, including A Bigger Picture, which Vanessa, who I just read the essay from, has written and is being released in November, which is about an African perspective on the climate crisis and, you know, climate injustice, inequality, how it intersects with all these issues. There are also a lot of other books. I heard about one recently by Maya Rose Craig, who is also known as Bird Girl. You might have heard of her. She's done a lot of activism. And she compiled a book with pieces of writing from specifically youth activists of colour from all around the world. And there are a lot of other sort of books and resources like this. So I'm not sure I would plan on making a sequel, although who knows where the future will take us. But there are definitely a lot of other things that you can read.
Okay. Thanks very much for reading that. Mike, have you got any comments on what you heard there, if you did hear it?
Yeah, I did. I think as Grace was saying, I think that I think other people what are doing is very inspiring, and I think that I certainly echo what you're saying, that everything that you do makes a difference, as I've said before. So whatever you do, it inspires you, it inspires your neighbors, it inspires your community. So do what you can, that's it, and you know, don't burn out over it, but you know, because this needs to be a joyful change, you know, rather than just being fearful about the future, let's imagine the better world, the more beautiful world our hearts know is possible. Let's imagine that.
Yeah, I think imagining things in the future is a very good way of, you know, helping ourselves. Verity, just any comments just on what you heard from Grace just then?
I imagine being a bit younger than I am today is quite an anxious thing to be. I think it's probably very easy to think, what's the point? If you're constantly being told that the planet that you're living on is not going to survive well into the future and provide a healthy environment for you to live in, I can't see how that message is going to help you enjoy your life. Really, you either ignore it or you get involved, but I think that's probably a fewer people really get stuck in, like people like Grace have.
But we're not going to enjoy our lives as much in the future, are we? I mean, by our current standards, because we're going to have to make big sacrifices, and that's what people don't want.
No, people don't go for it, Mike.
Yeah, go on.
I think that the picture that sometimes portrayed, that actually having a better climate and having a cleaner air is somehow sackcloth and ashes, and it's going to be worse. But having clean air that we breathe that doesn't give us asthma, for example, is going to be a better world to live in, with vegetables that not full of pesticides, and that knowing that our neighbours and our neighbours in further away are actually living healthy lives. So actually, cleaning up the planet will only be, you know, is only a good thing. It doesn't, you know, sometimes we're resistant to change, but you know, when we get there, it'll, you know, we can imagine the world being a much better place.
Okay, yeah, good point. Nikki, anything to say from what Grace was saying?
That was a really powerful piece of writing, and I don't think it's just going to help young activists. I think the people that need to read it are the generations above, who are, as Grace said earlier, the ones who are making some of the really big decisions now. So yes, can we send some copies to number 10, to Rishi Sunak, who doesn't really seem to get the whole climate thing. I think that, yeah, they're the people that need to hear these voices. And I think, you know, it's great that Grace has compiled this, but they're the people that need to listen.
Well, just a very quick round now. We've got about a minute and a half left. Just what are the chances of any of these COP29 objectives being met by 2030. I mean, it does seem a very short period of time in which to completely change everybody's minds. Mike, have you got anything to say on that?
We don't know. And the thing is that we don't know when a tipping point happens. So the thing is that if everybody just does what they can, then that will create the ground. But because you never know, you know, it's like going along a river, you reach a waterfall and then it changes suddenly. So that can happen. And we just have to do our bit.
Grace?
Well, I don't know all the scientific, you know, statistics around it. So I'm sure there's a scientific answer to that question. And also, you know, it depends on all the political decisions. But I think that we would need a huge attitude shift if we hope to achieve those objectives.
Nikki?
Yeah, I'd agree. And I think it's just really important, which I think has been echoed by other people on the call so far, that leaders understand that we're watching and that we care, because it can just feel like this thing that, you know, is way above our heads. We don't get any say. It's global leaders meeting. And yeah, I think if they don't understand that we're all watching and that we all care. So I think, you know, as much as you might want to do other things with the time, I think it's important to actually see what's going on in these negotiations and put pressure on.
Okay. Finally, Verity.
I mean, we've all got power to do what we can, and by pressuring the people where we spend our money, they in turn pressure the politicians a little bit stronger. We have to keep that pressure on. It's important, and do what we need to do ourselves. You know, sort your own backyard out, don't mow your lawn. Step one, you know.
Okay. Well, good luck to everybody in your endeavours. And thanks very much for taking part in this programme today. That's all we've got time for. So we'll be back in 2 weeks' time, hopefully, for another edition of All About Frome. Thanks for listening.